Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear stories from Anna Mateo and John Russell. Later, Brian Lynn presents this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, here is Anna Mateo.
How a sperm and an egg come together has long been a mystery. Now, new research by scientists in Austria provides interesting insight. It shows that fertilization works like a lock and key in animals that have a backbone, from fish to people. Such animals are called vertebrates. We discovered this mechanism that's really fundamental across all vertebrates, as far as we can tell, said co-author Andrea Pauli. He spoke to the Associated Press from the Research Institute of Molecular Pathology in Vienna, Austria. The team found that three proteins in sperm join to form a sort of key that unlocks the egg. The process permits the sperm to attach to the egg. The research findings come from studies in zebrafish, mice, and human cells. They show how this process has continued over millions of years of evolution. The findings appear in the science magazine Cell. Scientists already knew about two proteins, one on the surface of the sperm and another in the tissue of the egg. Working with an international team, Pauli's lab used Google DeepMind's artificial intelligence tool, AlphaFold, to help them find and identify a new protein. The protein permits the first molecular connection between sperm and egg. The developers of AlphaFold won a Nobel Prize earlier this month. However, what the researchers did not know until now was how the proteins worked together as a team to get the sperm and egg to recognize each other, Pauli said. Scientists still do not know how the sperm gets inside the egg after it attaches. They say they hope to explore that next. Pauli said such research could help other scientists understand infertility better or develop new birth control methods, also called contraceptives. The work provides targets for the development of male contraceptives, said David Greenstein in an email to AP. Greenstein is a genetics and cell biology expert at the University of Minnesota and was not involved in the study. The latest study also highlights the importance of this year's Nobel Prize in chemistry, he said in the email. I'm Anna Mateo.
The space rock that hit Earth 66 million years ago and caused the deaths of many life forms, including dinosaurs, was not the largest object to ever strike our planet. One meteorite up to 200 times bigger hit the planet 3.26 billion years ago, causing worldwide destruction. But, as new research shows, that event may have been helpful for the early development of life. The meteorite may have served as a giant fertilizer bomb. In other words, it may have supplied the key nutrients phosphorus and iron for the bacteria and other organisms that existed at the time. Researchers studied the effects of this meteorite strike using evidence from ancient rocks in an area in northeastern South Africa. The area is called the Barberton Greenstone Belt. Researchers found many signs that life quickly came back after the strike. Life not only recovered quickly once conditions returned to normal within a few years to decades, it actually thrived, said Nadia Drabone of Harvard University. Drabone was the lead writer of the study that appeared recently in the scientific publication Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Earth was a much different place when the meteorite strike took place. At the time, during the Paleoarchean era, meteorite strikes were larger and more common. At this time, Earth was something of a water world. There was essentially no oxygen gas in the atmosphere and oceans, and no cells with nuclei, said study co-writer Andrew Knoll. The meteorite was rich in carbon and also contained phosphorus. Its diameter was around 37 to 58 kilometers, Drabone said, meaning its mass was 50 to 200 times the mass of the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs. The effects of the hit, or impact, would have been quick and serious, Drabone suggested. The impact force would have caused a dust storm that circled the world and turned the sky black within hours, she explained. It also would have likely had a big effect on the ocean and created a lot of heat, possibly boiling the upper part of the oceans. Drabone said it probably would have taken years for the dust to settle and for the atmosphere to cool enough for the water vapor to return to the ocean. But the meteorite would have contained a large amount of phosphorus. It is an important nutrient for molecules central to storing and sharing genetic information. Powerful ocean waves also would have mixed iron-rich deep waters into shallower waters, creating a good environment for many kinds of microbes. Iron provides microbes with an energy source. Imagine these impacts to be giant fertilizer bombs, Drabone said. We think of meteorite impacts as being disastrous, Drabone said. But 3.2 billion years ago, life was a lot simpler. Microorganisms are relatively simple, versatile, and they reproduce at fast rates, Drabone added. The evidence of the hit included chemical signatures of the meteorite, small circular structures formed from rock melted by the impact, and pieces of seabed mixed with other debris in sedimentary rock. Early life was resilient in the face of a giant impact, Drabone said. I'm John Russell. Thank you.
Astronomers have made a surprising discovery about the first brown dwarf ever identified. New observations suggest the object is actually two brown dwarfs orbiting each other. The American Space Agency, NASA, describes a brown dwarf as an object that straddles the dividing line between stars and planets. Brown dwarfs form like stars. This means they can grow dense and hot enough to collapse under their own gravity. But they never grow dense or hot enough to begin the process of nuclear fusion needed to turn into a star, NASA said. Because of this, brown dwarfs are sometimes called failed stars. Many brown dwarfs are similar to gas giant planets and weigh just a few times more than the mass of Jupiter. Others can be much larger. The first brown dwarf was discovered in 1995 by researchers from the California Institute of Technology, Caltech. The discovery was made with the help of the Institute's Palomar Observatory near San Diego, California. But after many years of studying the object, known as Gliese 229b, scientists wondered why its brightness was less than expected for an object of its size. New research now shows that the brown dwarf is actually two objects. The observations came from the Very Large Telescope, which sits in a desert area of northern Chile. Those observations showed that one of the brown dwarfs is about 38 times the mass of Jupiter, while the other is 34 times Jupiter's mass. In a statement, the researchers said, "Data collected by the telescope suggests the two objects orbit each other every 12 days. That is less than half the time it takes for the Moon to orbit the Earth. The observed brightness levels of the pair match what is expected for two small, dim brown dwarfs in this mass range," the statement added. The two brown dwarfs are gravitationally linked to each other in what is known as a binary system. Such a situation is commonly observed among stars, but is rare for brown dwarfs. After the discovery, the two objects were given new names, Gliese 229bA and Gliese 229bB. The brown dwarfs are believed to orbit a star called a red dwarf about 18 light years away. A light year is the distance light travels in 1 year, about 9.5 trillion kilometers. The two sit about 19 light years away from our solar system. The research was co-led by Jerry Schwen, a graduate student at Caltech. He said in a statement that Gliese 229b was always considered the poster child for a brown dwarf. "And now we know we were wrong all along about the nature of the object," he added. "It's not one, but two. We just weren't able to probe separations this close until now." Astronomers had identified brown dwarf pairs before, but never any that orbited each other so closely. The research results recently appeared in a study in the publication Nature. The team that discovered Gliese 229b in 1995 included Rebecca Oppenheimer. At the time, she was a Caltech graduate student. She is now an astrophysicist at the American Museum of Natural History in New York City. She was also a member of the latest research team. Oppenheimer said, "It shows you how weird the universe is and how different solar systems are from our own." She added that she sees the new finding as the most exciting and fascinating discovery in this area of astrophysics in many years. Caltech's Jerry Schwinn said the discovery suggests there might be other brown dwarfs closely orbiting each other. He added that he hopes the latest finding can lead to a greater understanding of brown dwarf development. "We still don't really know how different brown dwarfs form and what the transition between a giant planet and a brown dwarf is," Schwinn said. He added, "This goes to show how complex and messy the star formation process is. We should always be open to surprises." I'm Brian Lynn.
Now, Brian Lynn joins me to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Brian.
Of course, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, your report was about a new discovery made about mysterious space objects called brown dwarfs. The first one of these objects was identified in the 1990s. How many have been discovered since then?
So, astronomers have identified thousands of brown dwarfs since that first discovery in 1995, and many of those have come in recent years due to major advances in technology and the instruments used to identify the objects. Scientists believe brown dwarfs exist in many different locations, but they are not that easy to identify. This is because they are small, cold, and not very bright compared to many planets and stars.
And what are some of the methods being used today to find more brown dwarfs to study?
One of the most used technologies in these kinds of identifications is radar. And one of the instruments used by the researchers in this study was radar-based. The instrument is part of the European Southern Observatory's Very Large Telescope that was responsible for this discovery. And in this case, for example, the radar instrument was used to record movements of molecules in the atmosphere of the brown dwarfs. And this led to the researchers realizing there were actually two brown dwarfs instead of one.
And what about the use of artificial intelligence technology in these discoveries?
Yes, this is a technology, too, that is increasingly being used by astronomers, although I don't believe it was used in this particular study. But one thing AI can help with is to analyze huge amounts of data collected by scientific instruments. Amounts of this kind of data can be quickly processed by AI systems that would likely take humans years to complete.
Okay, thanks so much for being here, Brian, and thank you for that interesting report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
My name is Anna Mateo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
My name is Jill Robbins.
You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Lesson 43 of the Let's Learn English series, Ana is on her way to teach a ukulele class. She realizes that she has lost something important. Let's listen.
Hey there! Tonight, I am teaching my ukulele class. It is far away, so I am going to ride the metro. Oh no! I lost my wallet! It has my metro card, my credit card, and my money! Oh no! It's times like this I remember my father's important words. He said, Ana, never, no wait, always have emergency money. It's empty. Time for Plan B. Extra emergency money. No, it's empty too. Ana, it's time for Plan C.
We often talk about having a Plan B for when something doesn't go as planned. Ana tells us her father said she should always have emergency money. In the video, we see her pull an envelope out of her bag, but it's empty. The same thing happened with the envelope in her boot. What do you think her plan C will be, Jill?
Ana has made some good friends, so I think she'll call one of them to ask for help. Let's find out. Listen for the way Ana asks her friend for a favor.
Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Ana. What's up?
I'm stuck downtown without any money. Would you be able to come downtown, please?
Ana, I can't. I'm too busy. I have to give a big presentation in 1 hour. Sorry.
That's okay. Good luck with your presentation.
Thanks.
Time for Plan D.
More friends may be getting phone calls, it seems. It's a little awkward, isn't it, to ask friends for money? Did you notice how Ana asked Marcia for help?
I did. She uses a modal verb, would, as she asks,
would you be able to come downtown, please?
This sentence pattern is common when we feel we might be asking someone to make a big effort to help us. When we ask, would you be able to? We are being very polite and giving the other person a chance to say no.
We could say that we are afraid we might be imposing. That's spelled I-M-P-O-S-I-N-G. Imposing on someone by making a request for something like borrowing money. To impose is to expect someone to do more than you usually ask them to do.
Another phrase we use if we feel we are imposing on someone is, would you do me a favor? Let's listen to find out how Ana asks her other friends for help. Listen for a modal verb.
Hi, Jonathan. How's it going?
Hey, Ana. Things are great. What's up?
Well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
What?
See, I lost my wallet, and I'm stuck downtown, and I...
Ana, I wish I could. I'm at the airport with my mother. Her flight leaves in 2 hours.
That's okay. Tell your mom to have a nice trip.
I do wish I could help. Thanks.
Bye.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Did you hear a modal verb, listeners? We hear Ana using another modal verb, could, when she asks Jonathan to give her some money. Like would, the modal verb could softens the request and makes it more polite.
Well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
Jonathan uses could 2 times when he answers.
Anna, I wish I could. I'm at the airport with my mother. Her flight leaves in 2 hours.
That's okay. Tell your mom to have a nice trip.
I do wish I could help. Thanks.
Bye.
So everyone is being polite, but Anna is still stuck without any money. There's one more thing about the language we hear in this lesson. Anna says,
well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
We use wonder in polite questions, like this. Andrew, I wonder if you're going to be busy tonight.
No, I'm not busy. Why?
Well, I have a project I need help with. I need a tall person who can reach the top shelves in my office.
Hold on a minute there, Jill. I'll be glad to do you a favor, but first, let's get back to the story. Anna has one more friend to call, Ashley.
This is serious. Time for Plan E.
Hello?
Hi, Ashley. What you doing?
Oh, hi, Anna.
Ashley, I was wondering, would you be able to come downtown and could you give me $20?
Anna, I can't.
I'll pay you back the money, I promise.
Anna, I'm not worried about the money. I'm babysitting.
Ashley is caring for a young child, or babysitting, so she can't come downtown to help. What is Anna going to do?
I remember she said she was going to her ukulele class. Maybe she can use her music to help her ask for money.
Let's listen and find out.
Well, plans A, B, C, D, and E did not work. Think, Anna, think! Time for plan F! Won't you give? Could you? Thank you very much, sir. Would you give me money? Won't you give? Oh, thank you very much. Could you give? Won't you give me money? Till next time. Won't you give me money?
Listeners, at the end of this lesson, you can hear Anna busking. That's a word we use to describe when someone performs on the street and asks the people passing by to drop some money into a hat to show their appreciation for the performance. To see her and Dr. Jill in her role as a passerby, go to learningenglish.voanews.com and watch Lesson 43 of the Let's Learn English series.
You can also find a fun board game in the lesson for practicing polite requests. Listeners, have you ever lost your wallet or something important like Anna did in this lesson? What did you do? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or in the comments on our YouTube channel. And remember that you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.